scholars from different areas have come together. I don't know how many, about over
I'm not sure how many, dozen, but quite
maybe,
a few.
I don't know. But quite a few people have come and put together this really easy to understand study Bible. So basically, if you have trouble looking at a certain passage or a certain verse, there's notes on here for you to dig deeper in the Word of God and to help you to understand for yourself how to understand the Bible in a much deeper way. And so we're also going to give this away too.
That's right.
It's not going to be for a charge, right?
No charge. No.
Okay, no charge.
No.
So this will also be free, but you have to come out here not only for 6 nights, but 12 nights.
12 nights. So that means some of you are almost halfway there. What do you say? That's great, right? So almost halfway there.
So on your 12th night, you mark it on there, you raise your hand, you will receive this wonderful study Bible that takes you through the New King James Version. It takes you through the Bible in a very systematic way, and in a way that you can delve deeper into God's Word and understand who Jesus is much better for you.
That's right. So we just want to encourage you guys. Thanks for coming out to APOC 2012, and please remember to encourage your friends to come. Friday night is a big night, and we're looking forward to everyone coming out on Friday, and you can still work for getting that book. Someone new coming Friday night could still get that book or the Bible. So God bless you. And at this time, we're going to have our opening prayer. Mr. Eddie Banks is going to come out and have our prayer.
Good evening. It's good to see so many here tonight. As is our custom, we'd like to ask that you just pause as you take a moment for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for these meetings. We thank you for safety and getting us here and through this week so far. We thank you for what we've been learning, and we ask that tonight that everything that's presented might be clear and understandable, and that it will be a blessing to those who are here. And we want to remember those who are not here tonight for whatever reason. Please be with them, that they might be able to return at a later date. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. Wow, we're tired and it's only Wednesday. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I have about 5 minutes to give you a health nugget. My name's Elizabeth, I forgot my name tag. But let's talk really briefly and quickly about something very important to our health. And as you can see on the screen, the topic that I chose, something that I think is very important for us to talk about. What am I gonna talk about? Okay, many of us may not be truthful about how many soft drinks we take, but if truth be told, I'm sure that most of us would be found guilty to be drinking quite a few of these sugary drinks. And you know what? The United States is right up there ahead of the world, and whatever we do seems to be something that everybody wants to follow. So guess what? Whatever we do sets an example. So we think about not just ourselves, but also about the rest of the world and the decisions that we make for our health. Did you know that in the last 25 years, we have doubled our consumption of sugary drinks, of sodas, or pops, whatever you want to call them? Can you imagine? We've more than doubled. Now, if you are younger than 25 years old, this may not mean much to you, but I hope that some of our examples this evening can give you an idea of how much this is. In a year, we are drinking about 56 gallons. Do you know how much that is? I don't really know. It's about 212 liters of soda consumption a year. That's a lot of soda. And guess what? We're drinking more soda than we are water in this country, unfortunately. Now, what is so special about these artificially flavored, chemically mixed carbonated drinks with phosphoric acid and sweeteners and preservatives and caffeine? Why do we like them so much? And what kind of health impact do they have in our bodies? Well, what's the first thing that comes to mind when you think of sodas, the component that they have?
Sugar.
Would you come and help me, please, really quickly? Yes, please, come and help me.
Sure. I don't think so.
Oh, good. You can help me do an example. I'm going to give you some sugar right here, and I'm going to give you a teaspoon. And if you can start filling this cup with sugar, and I'll tell you when to stop. We're all going to count out loud. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, keep counting, 7, 8. Okay, you can stop. This is how much sugar is in a very small sugary drink, soda drink. But most people drink a little bigger soda. So let's add a little more and see how much sugar people usually take with a drink. 9, 10, 11, and 12. Thank you very much. Appreciate your help. Maybe you can think about this next time that you take one drink of soda. Yes, that is a lot of sugar. And you know what? It's about a third of the total sugar consumption in this country. Sugar alone. And some may say, well, I do sugar-free or it has a different kind of sweetener to it. We'll talk about that in a second. So yes, about 8 to 12 teaspoons of sugar. What does a lot of sugar in a drink do to our immune system? It tells you right there, weakens. So especially flu season right now, what's gonna happen? A lot of more colds, yes. So it can decrease your body's ability to fight infection by 60% for the next five hours. So you can't fight the infection very well. What else do you think about when you think about sodas? What kind of energy is it giving you?
Caffeine.
Okay, caffeine, we'll talk about that. Talk a little bit about unbalanced nutrition. Some people in our country, you'll notice that they're getting bigger and bigger, but that doesn't mean that they are well-nourished. They're actually more malnourished than they were before. And this is because we're taking a lot of empty calories, and we don't have enough B vitamins, enough minerals. We have too many calories in just one of the drinks that we have. Did you know that about 1 out of 5 children less than 2 years old already drink a lot of soda? Our little children, they're drinking soda, 1 in 5. Okay, so we were talking a little bit about the extra calories. It doesn't take much to put on the pounds when we are drinking a lot of these empty calories. Now we're seeing, of course, a rise in obesity, we're seeing a rise in hypertension, a rise in diabetes, and a lot of it, we can blame it on just the amount of consumption of soda in our country. Yup, takes about 3,500 calories to make 1 pound of fat, and we are taking about 64,000 calories of soda. Isn't that impressive? Okay, I'm gonna go a little quicker here because I don't have a lot of time. So how about people that say, well, my soda is a Diet Coke, Diet whatever you wanna call it. What does that mean? Does it make it better?
No, it works.
Why does it make it worse? Okay, it's got chemicals to make it sweet, right? That's what you said? We can go into more detail about that. But all those extra chemicals are sure gonna have their effect on our bodies. And I need to finish really quickly. One more thing that we talked about is caffeine. A lot of caffeine in our drinks. Also, dehydration. We're more dehydrated than we are hydrated when we're taking our drinks. And guess what, folks? Just in soda, if we could just cut out the soda from our diet, take it away from our homes. We tell our children sometimes, don't drink the soda, but guess what? It's sitting right there on the counter, and it tastes good. There's a lot of chemicals in there that will make it taste good. If you want to make one healthy choice and change in your diet, cut out the sodas and drink water instead. Remember, we're not drinking enough water, we're drinking more soda than anything. I hope you learned something this evening. If anything, maybe you can picture it in your mind how much sugar we put in this cup and that you're taking with every soda. And I hope that you stay healthy. And God bless you. Thank you.
For real.
Hello. Good evening. Thank you very much, Sister Elizabeth. Now we're all going to the exciting part of the night before the sermon. It's the gift-giving part. Okay? We've been asking people to bring friends or loved ones to the series, and whoever brings the most will get a prize. So we'll be going through our routine again, okay? Who among you brought at least two people? Very good. These two? Okay, there's two of them. Okay, who among you brought three people? Three, very good. There's another one there, so we still need to narrow it down. Who among you brought four people? No one brought four? Is it a tie? So again, how many brought three? Is it two? Oh, there's two. Okay, what we'll do is, okay, we'll give another it's okay? Brother Matt, could you just give the gift, a special gift, a DVD of Conflict of the Ages?
Which one?
Thank you.
Okay, hold on a second, June. This was a little unplanned, but good evening, everyone, again. I have an announcement to make.
Okay.
Now, some people asked me, they said, Pastor, you know, it's really not fair if I only have one really good friend and I'm bringing them every night. Okay. And I don't get to bring, you know, 10, 20 people a night. Now, I'm glad for those of you that are bringing extra people, but here's the deal. I'm going to make a special deal with you. You guys ready? Who's ready?
Ready.
All right. For Friday night, if you will bring one person as a guest, not a family member, okay, you understand? So in other words, if you're a husband and you bring your wife, that doesn't count, or your kids, that's wonderful. We love your whole family to come. One guest, June, Justin, not a family member, everyone who brings a guest will get something on Friday.
Okay.
Pastor's word. All right. Thank you so much. God bless you guys.
Pastor's word, but I guess we have to find that gift, Pastor, right? No, we have gifts prepared.
Well, very good. How many of you were here last night? Can I see your hands? All right, how many of you took notes last night? Oh, there's a couple less. All right, make sure you're taking notes because we want to be able to not only remember what we learned the previous night, but also to share it with someone else. And also, as you remember, we have a quiz. And if you answer the quiz question right, you get a prize as well. But here's the stipulation. If I ask the question and you shout it out loud, you can't win the prize. So you have to raise your hand in order to win the prize. Fair? All right, question number one. How are we saved by? We're saved by grace through what? But here's the thing. You have to give me the Bible verse as well. And then you have to stand up and read the Bible verse. So we are saved by grace through what? And then you have to read the Bible verse for us. You got one right here?
Yes.
All right, go for it. Go ahead. Stand up.
You're saved by faith.
That's it.
And it's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8.
Why don't you read it for us?
It says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God."
Good. Did you get it right?
Yeah.
All right, amen. So you get a prize over here. All right, second and last question for tonight. There's only two tonight. Sorry about that. Second question, what is faith? David gave an example, a story. If you remember, it's about the centurion. What is the definition of faith? I think I saw him right here in the black sweater. Go ahead.
Hebrews 11:1, faith is the substance of things not seen and evidence of things not heard.
That's awesome. That's actually a really great verse. That's not the one that we're looking for. He's talked specifically through the centurion, the story of the centurion. But you're a very good Bible scholar right there. We're able to pull it out of his hat, okay? What is faith? We're going to go right here in the front.
Mm-hmm.
Taking God at his word. Is that right?
Yes.
Amen. All right. Taking God at his word. Thank you guys so much for your participation.
Amen.
Next up, we actually get to quiz the presenter, right? Is that right?
Okay.
So bringing on David out. How many of you guys have been blessed by David's presentation? Raise your hands. Amen? All right. Now, how many of you guys want to ask him a couple hard questions? Yeah? All right. We got two questions here tonight, David. You ready?
I got three.
You on your toes? Yeah? A little bit?
A little bit.
I don't think he's scared. You guys aren't asking hard enough questions yet, huh? Yeah, any hard questions you got, you can write them down. By the way, The question and answer box is in the back in the lobby. There's two boxes there that you might be interested in. Number one is the prayer box. If you have special prayer requests, you can write that in and we'll be happy to pray for you. Second thing is if you have any specific questions about anything in the Bible, anything, right?
Sure, anything.
Except for the Old Testament, right?
No, that's fine too. It's part of the Bible.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
But not Revelation, because that's hard.
Oh, come on. Jesus.
The whole thing? Hard.
Everything.
All right, any Bible question you have, you can write it down. And by the grace of God,
God's grace,
we're going to answer the question here. Okay, so question number one. Are you ready for this one?
By God's grace.
All right. This person asks, is there any way to build my faith stronger so that I can believe in God?
Is there any way I can build my faith so I can get stronger in God?
Correct.
Okay. The disciples asked the same question in Luke chapter 17. The Bible says in verse 5, Jesus, the disciples were there. Jesus was giving a powerful demonstration and a lesson. And they said, Lord, increase our faith. How do we get faith is the question. How do we get it?
By hearing.
By hearing. Where do we find that? In Romans chapter 10, verse 17, the Bible says, so faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So in order for me to increase my strength, strengthen my faith, where do I get it? By reading the word of God, by hearing it. And what does the word of God do for me? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, that the word of God is like a sword, sharper than any two-edged sword, right? And what does the sword do? Does it feel good when you're pricked by it? No, right? When you read the word of God, it convicts you of sin. It reveals to you your condition. So that's where grace comes in. So I get more faith by reading the word of God. And as I read the word of God, it convicts me of my sin, and it leads me to see my need for Jesus. So how do I increase my faith? How does it get stronger? I read more of the Bible. I study more of the Bible. It reveals to me my condition, and I'm able to come to Jesus and be changed by his grace.
Amen. How do you say it? What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. How do we increase our faith? We spend more time in God's word. Amen. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Second question. Now, this is a tough one. This is one that people have been thinking about for millennia.
Oh, wow.
You all right?
Okay. Let's try, brother.
All right. Second question. If God is a God of love, why is there so much suffering and sin in the world? A lot of us have asked this question, maybe sitting at on our beds at night. I'm wondering, too, if God's a God of love, why does he allow so many bad things to happen?
That's a good question, isn't it, huh, friends? A good question. And Friday, we'll be talking exactly about that. We'll be talking, why is there so much sin and suffering? But I'll give you one text to help your curiosity.
I was going
to
say, I'm kind of angry about that answer. Anyone else? Man, we wanted to ask.
Well, man, you guys haven't given me any gifts either.
Oh.
All I want.
Did anyone bring a gift for me?
Questions and everything.
No one brought him a gift? Come on, at least a sandwich or something? It's like a Subway not too far down the road.
Someone should say, grace is a gift. You have that, amen? All right, the Bible says in John chapter 10, verse 10, the Bible says, the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. But then Jesus says, I am come, that I may give life and life more abundantly. So Jesus is the one that wants to give me life, but not just life, life more abundantly. And the thief is the one that wants to steal, kill, and destroy.
But I thought yesterday you were the one who was a thief, right? The sign, you're the thief and the liar.
Yeah,
right?
But not everyone knows that. Not everyone was here. You're going to think everyone, I'm a thief or something. No, the devil is a thief. He is a thief and he's out to kill, steal, and destroy. And Friday, we'll find more about why is there so much sin, suffering in this world, and how we can have life and life more abundantly in Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, David. Can you guys say amen?
Amen.
Amen. One quick announcement. How many of you guys have ever heard of TruthLink before? Can I see a hand? Maybe three or four. Oh, perfect. Well, this will be great for the majority of you guys. Out on the back desk over there are five what we call quick guides, the TruthLink quick guides. There's five total. And what we're doing is we're going to be having a couple graduation ceremonies. On Friday, I believe, is our next graduation. Here's the thing. If you can go through five of our lesson guides, they're really, really easy. They're actually kind of fun, too. But all they are true and false questions. If you want to learn, how do I learn more about the Bible? How do I study the Bible? I want more. I mean, these meetings are great, but I want more. You're just hungry for more. Go outside to the back table on your way out. Pick up some of the quick guides, and if you accomplish all five of them, you will get to join the graduation ceremony on Friday. And don't worry, if that's kind of too early for you, we're going to be having another one next week, and we'll let you know when that is. So grab some of these on the way out. There's 5 of them total. And if you finish all of them, not only do you get to graduate, but you get a free gift as well. How many of you guys say, hey, that might be something I want to do? Yeah? All right, take them out on the way. And by the way, anyone can participate in this, whether you're a first-time guest or you've been here for a while. All right, and we'll move on with the program. Good evening again. Happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday.
Oh, you guys sound so sad. You guys happy?
Yeah.
You guys are not convincing. Well, I'm happy. It was a good, productive day, and I might knock this thing out because I like to walk a lot. Okay, I think the sugar's gone. No temptation there. How many of you have been here all 5 nights? Let me see your hands. Wow, God bless all of you. Amen. How many of you, this is your first night here? Let me see your hand. Very first night. Alrighty, well, praise the Lord. I'm glad that you guys have been here. I know that you will enjoy it because the theme is apocalypse. Jesus Christ, amen. And who cannot be excited when we talk about Jesus? Just something that thrills my soul. Before I start into the message, we want to look up on the screen. There is an announcement that we want to give. We're getting so many questions. And obviously, we only have time for 2 or 3, as Justin asked me them. But this is one way that we can answer them, and we can either send the answer through via email, or if we have time, we could give the answer here. But if you can see on the screen, the website or the email address that you can send your questions. If you're feeling like, man, none of my questions are being answered, this is a great way that we can strive to answer all your questions by God's grace. Question and answers, you can send it to apox2012mentone@gmail.com. That is, if you have any questions about the series or anything about life or struggles or prayer requests or anything you have
That's a beautiful email address you can send, apox2012mentone@gmail.com, and by God's grace, we'll do our best to send the answer as soon as we can. But I'm thankful that you guys are asking questions. That means you are thinking. And that's always something good, amen? Amen. We're sleepy, but we're going to wake up pretty soon. It's fine. But once again, I want to thank you for taking time out and coming out here. I know you guys have family and you guys are busy, but I want to thank you for coming out, not to hear a man speak, but to hear the Word of God. And I really do thank you. Tonight is a subject that it just really excites me. Do any of you remember the title of tonight's message? Oh, it's not even there. The loudest what? Oh, you guys are good. The loudest alarm clock. Precisely that. And I'm very excited to share with you this message. But before we dive into it, let's say a word of prayer to Heavenly Father to guide us and to lead us. Let's bow our heads for prayer. My Father, which is in heaven, I am so thankful that you've given us the opportunity tonight to dive into your word once again, Father. We have a lot to cover tonight. Keep us awake. Keep us alert. But most importantly, Father, I pray that Jesus may be uplifted tonight, as by God's grace he has been these last nights, Lord. I want our hearts to thrill within and to our minds to think that we may accept the truth only as it is in Jesus. Grant us your Holy Spirit to help us have understanding. For I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, please turn to them to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation has been the theme of this series, the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, and I want to go into our verse for tonight. It's the theme verse for tonight's message. Revelation chapter 1, I'm looking at verse 18. This message is called the loudest alarm clock. What are you talking about, David? What alarm clock? I don't like alarm clocks. I hate them. I feel like whenever it's sounding, to throw them across the room. What are we talking about tonight? The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1. Are we there?
Amen.
Couple people. If you're there, let me hear a hearty, happy, awake, amen.
Amen.
All right. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. I am he that liveth and was what?
Dead.
And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Who is talking here? Jesus is speaking here, and he is saying, I am he that liveth, and yes, I was once dead, but now I am alive, and I have the keys of hell and death. So here is Jesus giving the most powerful declaration. He's saying, I know how it feels to be dead. I know how it feels not to think, not to be in the grave. I know how it feels, but now I tell you the truth, I am alive. I have the keys that can unlock any tombstone today. I have it because I was once there. What are we talking about tonight is an important subject. A very important one. I want us to think. But who has the keys of hell and death?
Jesus
and Jesus alone. I want to show you something else. Go to your Bibles to Romans chapter 14. What does this mean that Jesus has the keys of hell and death? What does he mean when he says, I was once dead and now I am alive? What relevance does that text have in my life today? I'm looking at Romans. It's after the Gospels. It's after Acts. Romans is right there. Romans chapter 14, verse 7. And when you're there, let me hear your beautiful voices by a awake amen.
Amen.
All right. Romans chapter 14. I'm looking at verse 7. For none of us liveth to himself. And no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. Isn't that very comforting? If I'm alive, I am God's. If I am dead, I am God's. And why does Paul say that? Look at verse 9. For to this end, Christ both died and rose and revived that we might be Lord both of the dead, or that he might be, excuse me, that he might be Lord both of the dead and living. Christ wants to be the Lord of your life. Whether you're dead or alive, if you've given your heart to God, you're his. Tonight's message, we are talking about what happens when someone dies. What happens when someone dies? Is he floating in the sky somewhere? Is he watching down upon us? Is he looking as we struggle on this earth? Or maybe another extreme, maybe when you die, you're in hell burning and burning, suffering and suffering. I am confused. What is it? What happens when I die? The Bible has a lot to say about it. What does the Word of God say about this message of hope, friends, about what happens when we die? You see, in the beginning, God says, commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden, you may freely what?
Eat.
You may freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely what?
Die.
So what happened? We know the story. Eve got curious. She went to the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And as she was looking at the fruit, who came there? Who was there? Satan, the serpent. And he told her the very first lie ever mentioned in the Bible. The very first lie. And the very first lie ever given was what? You will not surely what?
Die.
But did God just tell them that if you eat it, you will die? And the serpent saying, oh, you will not die. And see, this very lie, the very first lie that was given to mankind, is a lie that has penetrated many of the minds of the earth. You will not die. When you die, truly, you're not really dead. You're somewhere else or doing something. You're not really dead. This is a lie that's been reiterated from the beginning of this earth. So what is the truth? Adam and Eve ate the fruit, they sinned, they got kicked out of the garden, and the reason why they got kicked out of the garden, the Bible says, the man has become like one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. So right away, Adam and Eve took a bite of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, a tree which God told them, if you eat, you will die. They took a bite of it, they became sinners. And immediately, what God says is, listen, we got to get them out of here. If they eat of the tree of life, they will live as sinners forever. And that was Satan's plan. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. So there we have it. The first lie introduced, accepted by Adam and Eve, got them kicked out of the garden. Paradise. And I like to recognize this thought. If this lie was accepted into their lives, and because it was accepted, it kicked them out of the Garden of Eden, what do you think will happen for those who still believe in that lie? What do you think of those who still are believing not what God's word says, but what the serpent says? Do you think if I am accepting a lie that comes straight from the enemy, do you think I will make it to heaven? If this lie kicked Adam and Eve out of the garden, what do you think this lie, if I accept it, will do for me and salvation? It's not about what was wrong about the fruit. The fruit was harmless. It was what God said. God said, if you do that, you will die. They accepted to accept Satan's words above God's. Tonight, by God's grace, we're going to get our answers straightly from God. Is that all right with you?
Amen.
We're not listening to Satan anymore. We're not going to listen to Satan's lies. We're going to listen to the Word of God. Why? Because I want to be in heaven.
Amen.
Oh, that was weak. You want to be in heaven?
Amen.
But you have to make me work hard tonight, huh? I want to make it to heaven. And the only way I can make it to heaven is if I'm listening and I'm obeying and I have Jesus in my life. I want to get all these lies out so I can have all the truth within. Amen? The Bible says now, you shall eat of the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face, you shall eat bread till you return to the what? Until you return where? To the ground. For out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and dust you shall return. So here we have it. The Bible says that eventually as someone dies, he will become as dust as he was made in the beginning. So how were we made in the beginning? The Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, and the Lord God formed man of the what?
Dust
of the ground. and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living what?
Being.
So what were these ingredients that caused mankind to be formed? Body plus breath equals a what?
Living
soul. So God bent down on his knees, or however you would like to picture it, and he grabbed the dust from the ground. He started making Adam, and then he breathed into him the breath of life. We have now an ingredient of what equals a living soul. Body plus breath equals a living soul. But what is soul in the Bible? Many people get this confused. Is a soul something that floats around in the sky and just lives out in outer space or something? What is a living soul? The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 41, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. Now, who was it that was baptized? Was it a bunch of ghosts, floating spirits, or was it a person? It was people. The Bible says, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. 3,000 what?
Souls.
Let's look at another passage of scripture, Acts 27:37. And we were all in the ship, 216 what? So the souls that the Bible describes is a what? Is a person, is a living being. Amen. Is that clear? I want us to be together. Is that fine with you? Amen. We're getting it from the Bible. Let's look at another portion of scripture. Ezekiel 18:4. Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father, as well as the soul of the Son, is mine. The soul who sins shall die. Another name for soul in the Bible is person or life. Amen. All from Scripture. Didn't make it up. So a soul is a person. It's me. I'm a soul. David is a soul right here. You see me? Flesh and blood. I'm a soul. The Bible says it. Same passage of Scripture, Ezekiel 18, in another translation says, in today's English version says, the person who sins is the one who will die. I want it to be so clear. A soul is a
person.
Very good. There is no such thing in the Bible as an immortal soul. Only God is immortal. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17, now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor, glory, forever and ever. Amen. Who's the only one that's immortal?
God.
Very good. The King of kings and Lord of lords, who only has immortality. So what does it mean to be immortal? It means you cannot die. Very good. You guys are a smart bunch. I love you guys. You guys are getting it. The Bible uses the word soul how many times?
1600.
I only heard like five people. How many times?
1600.
1600 times, and never once does it use the words immortal soul. Interesting. Let's continue. So a living person minus the breath equals a corpse, a dead person. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. What does Job say? And while my breath is in me, and the spirit of God is in my nostrils, what we're looking at, what does spirit mean? But put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. His breath goeth forth, it returneth to his earth, and that very day his thoughts perish. The Old Testament Hebrew word for spirit is what?
Ruach.
Oh, let me hear it. Let me hear your Hebrew. Ruach. Let me hear it.
Ruach.
Oh, you got that? Ruach.
Ruach.
Oh, that's pretty good. I'm not Hebrew, so sounds pretty good. Oh, we have a friend coming up here. He is a living
soul.
All right, very good. All right, brother.
That's exactly right. Good evening, everyone. We're sorry to make this pause and hold your breath for a minute. But if you have a Nissan Quest that is dark blue, we can't tell the color because it's black outside right now, or dark outside, your alarm is going off constantly. Oh, okay, sorry. Thank you so much, sister. We appreciate it. All right, now back to your regularly scheduled program.
All righty. That car isn't a living soul, amen? Amen. The car isn't a soul, but I am a soul. He's a soul. Now let's get back to the Hebrew. I want to hear it again. The Old Testament Hebrew word for spirit is?
Ruach.
Ooh, very good. I'm with the Hebrew scholars. Which means?
Breath.
Now let me ask you a question. When God breathed into Adam and Eve, or breathed into Adam, what would you say that was? It was a spirit. It was a? The breath. It was, in Hebrew?
Ruach.
Very good. The spirit and soul are the same.
No.
What? Are you sure? The spirit and the soul are
different.
What is the soul?
A living person.
Here I am. I'm a soul. What is the breath?
Spirit.
Okay, it's the one that gives life, right? It takes two ingredients to be a living soul. It takes the dust of the ground and the breath of life equals a living soul. So soul, breath, spirit is just one of the ingredients that equals a soul, but it's not a soul. The spirit or breath of life is the power of life that goes back to God. Amen. So it's like the light bulb. Lots of light bulbs up there. And the actual light bulb is the actual, like the glass, is like our body. And electricity is like the breath. It's what gives it the light. If I didn't have the glass, I can't have the light. If I don't have the light, you know, you need the both to be a light bulb. So if one is gone, the whole thing doesn't really work very well. Are you with me? Are you sure?
Yes.
Can I move forward? Very good. The Bible teaches that breath and spirit are the same thing. All the while, my breath in me and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils. Breath, spirit, same thing. Soul, spirit, they are
different.
Very good. The body without the spirit or breath is
dead.
Question. Is there any consciousness in death?
No.
Wow. You guys are very quick. What does the Bible say? Ecclesiastes 9 verse 5. For the living know that they will what?
Die.
But the dead know not anything, and they have no more reward. The dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down in silence. So if I'm dead right now, if I'm passed away, am I thinking about who's going to pay the bills?
No.
Am I thinking about, man, I have a test tomorrow?
No.
No, right? I have no consciousness. I'm not thinking about anything. I'm just dead. I have nothing. No praise. It's completely silent in the grave. If a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my heart service, I will wait till my change comes. You shall call, and I will answer you. It's describing Job's experience. Go on, God. If I was to die, I am to wait in the grave until you call me back up. I have no consciousness. I'm not going to be looking in the grave saying, God, why are you taking so long? I'm dead. The next thing I'll be waiting for or I'll hear is you calling me out of the grave. If I wait, the grave is my house. I have made my bed in the darkness. Death is a...
Sleep.
I think we're sleeping right now. Death is a what?
Sleep.
You're not dead, are you?
No.
We need to get some doctors to check our pulses. We are alive. So death is a what?
Sleep.
Let's see what the Bible says. Here's Jesus talking to Mary and Martha. Here's Jesus talking to the disciples. And Jesus, as he's talking to the disciples, he says, our friend Lazarus, what? But I go that I may wake him up. How many of you like being waken up if you're sleeping? How many of you love it? Oh, okay, maybe, okay, you like it, Ernie? All right, maybe because you're sleeping a little bit too long? Okay. But how many of you like to be woken up at like 3 in the morning? How many of you just love it? Let me see your hands. No one likes it, right? So Jesus is talking to Lazarus about Lazarus to the disciples. And he says, listen, friends, Lazarus is sleeping. I'm going to go wake him up. And what do you think they're thinking in their mind? Like, Jesus, you're not rude. Why would you do that? Look what they say. His disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. Like, Lord, he's sleeping. Leave him alone. It's fine. There's nothing wrong. Why do we have to go over there and wake him up? Jesus said plainly to them, Lazarus is dead. So notice from the mouth of Jesus, Jesus says about Lazarus, he is sleeping. They're like, well, let's just let him sleep. And he says, no, you don't get it. Lazarus is dead. So what is considered, like you're sleeping, you are dead. Death is considered sleeping. And listen what else he says. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. So now God is saying, I have something to share with you. Something powerful to share with you guys. But listen, as they were going there, Martha, the sister of Lazarus, comes to him and says, Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you have been here, my brother would not have what? Lord, if you were just here 4 days ago, my brother will still be alive. My brother will still be alive. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Amen? He says, your brother is just sleeping. He will rise again. Don't worry about it. And listen to her Bible, her biblical answer to this question, to this comment, excuse me. I know that he will arise again in the resurrection at the last day. Notice very closely, Martha studied her Bible. She knew what happens when you die. She notices, I know that my brother is not in the sky hanging out. I know he's not somewhere in hell or whatever. I know, Lord, that he's in the grave, and I know when he will come out. It's in the last day. It is in the last day, the resurrection. I know that, Lord. And Jesus says this startling statement to her. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, he shall live. Oh, that must bring so much joy to you, friends. Amen. How many of you have lost a loved one? My dear friends, by God's grace, guess what the Bible says? Guess what it says? He who believes in me, though he die, he will live again. What precious hope we have. So Jesus was there standing, and the Bible says that Jesus wept. Was he weeping because he had no more, he didn't have any power at that time to resurrect Lazarus?
No.
Was he weeping because he was looking at the people and they had so much, they didn't have that much faith that he could do that? Whatever you may think that why Jesus wept, the reason is maybe many thoughts. Maybe because of lack of faith. Maybe because he cared for Lazarus. Whatever it may be, he still has the power to resurrect them. So as Jesus removed the tears from his eyes, and as he looked at the tomb, he said, Lord, by this time, there is a bad order. He said, I'm going to resurrect him, remove the tomb, remove the stone. I'm going to take him out. And they're like, Lord, no, don't do that. He's already smelling right now. The Bible says he's been in there for 4 days, and it's not going to smell good, Lord. Don't you dare remove that stone. And they remove him. And Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth. Notice, Jesus didn't say, Lazarus, come from the sky. Notice, Jesus didn't say, Lazarus, come from hell. He said, Lazarus, come forth. And he did. The Bible says death is asleep. Death is a state of perfect rest or sleep until the resurrection when Christ wakes you up and says, now all sorrow is over. So when is this? The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others have no hope. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a whisper.
Shout.
With a what?
Shout.
You guys got to shout. With a what?
Shout.
With the voice of an archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. So notice, it's a description of when they will rise, the dead will rise, because those that are sleeping, is when Jesus Christ comes back the second time, he sounds that beautiful trumpet, the loudest alarm clock everyone has ever heard, and there we come. There those who are dead in Christ shall rise first.
Amen.
And what will happen to them? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:51, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be what? Changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. Pay close attention. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Here it is. Who is the only one at this moment who is immortal?
God.
But is that going to change?
Yes.
Is it going to change?
Yes.
When is it going to change?
When Jesus.
At the last day, when Jesus comes back the second time, he sounds the trumpet, the dead in Christ shall rise, he changes our vile body so we can be incorruptible. We can have immortality. Is that good news for you?
Amen.
Can you wait for that day until your bodies are changed? I can't wait. It's exciting. The Bible says it will happen. Right now there's no one on earth that is immortal except God. But God is saying soon you will be immortal as well if you're faithful. Let's keep going. The Bible says, so when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that it is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Death is swallowed up. Oh, Hades, where is your victory? Friends, these people will have victory even over death. I want to be part of that people, don't you?
Amen.
How about, I know, this may be new news for some of us. We may have been taught or others may have spoken differently about what happens when you die. We're going to look at some deadly delusions that people have been saying that are not so biblical. In Time magazine, they were giving out illustration on the New Age. Starring Shirley MacLaine, faith healers, challengers, space travelers, and crystal galore. Listen to what we're talking about. Spiritism claims the dead are not what?
Dead.
Who claims the dead are not dead?
Spiritism.
The fundamental principle of spiritism is that human beings survive bodily death, and that occasionally, under conditions not yet fully understood, we can communicate with those who have gone before. Does the Bible teach this?
No.
Who teaches this?
Satan.
Spiritualism or Satan. Spiritism claims the dead communicate with the living. There is no death in the graveyard. I have frequent talks with the dead. This is what spiritualists talk about, teach about. The birthplace of modern spiritualism, you may have heard of the Fox sisters, they claim there is no death. They are no dead. It's not coming from the Bible. Look at this. I believe that souls, who's a soul? She got it wrong. Who's a soul? I'm a soul, right? She says, I believe that souls, invisible entities, are part of the what? What's part of the cyclical? The souls. Invisible entities, that they are part of harmony of nature. None of it ever dies. It just changes forms. Who is saying this? The Bible? No. Look at what the Bible does say, though. In Revelation 12:9, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives how much of the world? The whole world. Listen to the news. How to contact your loved ones in heaven. More and more we're getting these thoughts that we can see Aunt Sue has passed away. We can see Uncle Bob. Movies are coming out about the sixth sense. Almost 70 million Americans say and think it's possible to communicate with the dead. Are you with me? People are saying, oh, you're not really dead. When you're alive, you're just floating around. Yeah, we can communicate with them. It's all fine. The Bible says, however, in Job 7:8, the eye of him that has seen me shall see me no more. Thine eyes are upon me, and I am not. The Bible says in Job 7:9-10, as a cloud is consumed and vanished away, so he that goeth down to the grave shall come up no more. He shall return no more to his house, neither shall his place know him anymore. Bible truth, friends. Straight from the Bible. When we are dead, our thoughts perish. We're not conscious. We're not floating around. Jesus said to Lazarus, come forth. He didn't say come from above. He didn't say come from the ground. What am I saying is this, friends. The dead, they go down to the grave. They're not going to go back and visit you. If so, the Bible says that Satan himself disguises himself or transforms himself into an angel of light. The Bible says, he shall return no more to his house, neither shall his place know him anymore. How about ghosts, David? What are these ghosts that many people are seeing? Or the angels that we're seeing everywhere? The Bible says, once again, I want to reiterate it, yet shall he be brought to the grave and shall remain in the tomb. You're dead, you're staying in the grave, in the tomb, until Jesus calls you out. No one has the power to call you out of the grave except Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
That's what the Bible teaches. No spiritualist person, they could try, but no one has the power except Jesus. And when will that happen?
The last trump.
Again, his sons come to honor, and he knoweth it not. And they are brought low, but he perceiveth not of them. For listen to this. So what is this? These angels, what are these things? These ghosts that are floating around. What are these things that may appear to be my loved ones that have passed in the grave? The Bible says in Revelation 16:14, for they are spirits of devils, working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth. Listen, Matthew 24:24. For there shall arise false Christs, false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. Notice this doctrine that is going about. 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly, that in latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. What was the devil's doctrine in the beginning? What was his first lie? You shall not surely what?
Die.
And do you think that lie is still being accepted today?
Of course.
Oh, you will not die. You can't die. Yeah. You may be that your loved one may be dead, but he's not really dead. He's floating around. He may be in heaven or in hell. He's around here. We can communicate with him. Friends, the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that this is a doctrine, not of God, but of who? I know it may be hard to accept. I understand that this may be new truth to some of us, but friends, there's comforting news. Our loved ones still have hope. Listen, I would rather my loved one be sleeping and restful, not suffering anymore, because many people would say, well, he's in a better place, he's in heaven. How is heaven a better place if my loved one's looking down upon me as I suffer and as I struggle? How is that a better place? Where he could look down and see his family members suffering and going through pain. I don't want that. How about this? Oh, I'm sorry, your loved one has been a bad person. He's in hell burning right now. How is that good news? Friends, I'm so thankful for the Bible. It says that they, whether they were good or bad, they're resting. Amen.
Amen.
And what gives me hope is Jesus has the keys. And no one else does. Jesus has the keys to unlock the tomb. So let's continue unlocking this devil's lie. You shall not surely die. Where do the dead go when they die? The Bible says in John 5:28, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his what? Will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of what?
Life.
And those who have done evil to the resurrection of what? So listen, those who have died in Christ, those who lived and accepted Jesus Christ in their life, where Jesus will resurrect them to life. Amen.
Amen.
And those who were not so good, who did not accept Jesus in their life, rejected Jesus, they will resurrect only to die. But I'm so thankful at this moment that they are sleeping. Rest, the Bible teaches. Listen to what Martin Luther says in the Christian Hope, page 37. This is Martin Luther. We shall sleep until he comes, and knocks on the little grave and says, Dr. Martin, get up. Then I shall arise in a moment and be happy with him forever.
Amen.
Heaven or hell, the Bible says, and behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give everyone according to his work. So what happens when you die? We will see them again. When? Then we who are alive shall remain, be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus shall we always be with the Lord. And may I add, with our loved ones who died in Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We shall ever be with the Lord. But how about this, David? You are nice. You missed something, though. How about this one? Let's see how you're going to get around this one, David. How about the thief on the cross? Didn't he go to heaven right away? The Bible says in Luke 23:42, then said Jesus, Lord, or then said the thief, then the thief said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your what?
Kingdom.
To your kingdom. And Jesus said, assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in
paradise.
See, David? You nice try. That was a cute little sermon. But David, what about this one? The Bible teaches if I die, like the thief, I'm going to go to paradise with Jesus. And Jesus said, today. So that means that the thief, as soon as he died, he went to paradise with Jesus. And that's where he's at. See, David, how are you going to get around this one? Question. Was the Bible written with punctuation? The Bible was not written with punctuation. It was added centuries later by the medieval church. So listen to this. Look at the comma here. Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. That's where the comma is. You see how it is in yellow right there?
Yeah.
Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. But notice the difference when the commas move. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today you shall be with me in paradise. Is there a difference because the comma was moved?
Yes.
Is there a significant difference?
Yes.
What does this one mean? If the comma was before today, that means what?
The thief's in heaven.
The thief, when he died, he went where?
Heaven.
To heaven. But when the comma's moved over there, what happens? He was just promising him today. I have a promise to you today that you will be in paradise. Amen.
Amen.
So you see the difference of the comma? Question, was it when the Bible was written in Greek and Hebrew, did it have punctuation?
No.
Who added that? Centuries later, people added that to make it easier to read. Here they got it wrong. Let me show you where else they got it wrong. The Bible says in Acts chapter 19, verse 12, you're going to love this one, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. I read it quickly. Watch this. So from that his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons. Are handkerchiefs really sick? Do you ever see a handkerchief walking into the doctor's office and say, I'm sick, help me? Do you ever see that? I have never seen that. So notice, if the comma was moved, notice the difference. So that from his body were brought unto the sick, if we put that there, right there, that makes, they were brought the sick, and they used the handkerchiefs and aprons to help relieve them of the evil spirits. So the transfer is now not only, is transferred not from the sick handkerchiefs, but to the sick. Okay, I got something good for you. How many of you are married? See your hands. Portion? Pick one. Raise your hands again. Who's here with your husband and your wife? Let me see your hands. Okay. Well, I'm going to pick on you two in the middle. What is your names?
Monica and Raul.
Monica and Raul. Very good. Monica and Raul. Let me ask you, was it very difficult for you to find a wedding dress? Was it easy or very difficult?
For me, it was easy.
For you, it was easy. Yeah, you didn't have to worry about it. Amen. But was it hard?
It
was stressful, right? But what if you had all the money? What if your husband was a billionaire? Would it be too hard?
No.
No, right? Just walk in. The story goes. There was a couple that was just about getting married, and a woman wanted to get the most perfect dress. So this woman flew over to Italy. And as she was in Italy, she was trying to find the most expensive, the most beautiful dress, the wedding dress. And as she was looking at all the stores, she was looking as she found the wedding dress. Most beautiful wedding dress. So she texted her husband. Husband, you won't believe it. I found the most perfect wedding dress. And he's like, wonderful. I'm so thankful you found the most perfect wedding dress for the most perfect woman. How much does it cost? And she says a ridiculous number. So high. And he writes back, no, price too high. He writes back, no price, too high. And she gets it, she's like, oh my, he loves me. No price is too high. This wedding dress probably costs $1 million, but my husband loves me so much. She writes it on the credit card. She brings it back home. She gets home and she's like, husband, look, the most perfect wedding dress, look at it. And he's like, okay, but I said no price too high. He forgot about the comma. The comma there says, no, price too high. Does the comma make a difference?
Yes.
Oh man, I don't know if that split up their marriage. I don't know. I don't know if she returned it or not. But you see the difference with the comma. Same thing with the thief on the cross. Same thing. Jesus told them, today you can have assurance because you accepted me into my life that you will be with me in paradise. He was not saying, today, let me show you how else we can prove that. Jesus says, remember when you come into your kingdom, okay. Did Jesus go to paradise that day?
No.
You guys are sure? He died, right? The Bible says, to him that overcometh, I will get to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Where is the paradise of God? The Bible says in Revelation 22, verse 1 and 2, that it is in the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river was the tree of life. It's in heaven. So the question is, the tree of life is close to the throne of God. So paradise is where God's throne is, in heaven. So did Jesus, as soon as he died, did he go to heaven that day?
No.
The Bible says that the day was preparation day, it was a Friday. His body that should remain not on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already what?
Dead,
they did not break his legs. So when they came to Jesus, they were about to break his legs because Sabbath was approaching. It was the seventh day, and he recognized, oh no, we got to break these legs. We got to kill them quicker. Quickly, Jesus was already what? Was he in paradise? Was he in heaven when he died? What happened? Mary Magdalene. Mary's running to the tomb the first day, the resurrection day, that first day of the week, Sunday. She runs over there. She's running over there to see the Lord. And Jesus, and finally she sees him, and she talks to him, and she says, Jesus said to her, touch me not. She wants to grab him, she wants to hold him. She just saw her master resurrect from the tomb. And Jesus tells her, do not touch me, for I'm not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascended to my Father and your Father and to my God and your God. From the Bible, straight from the Bible, did Jesus go to paradise? Did he go to heaven as soon as he died?
No.
No. He didn't. So did the thief on the cross go to paradise when he died?
No.
When will he go to paradise? From the Bible, amen? Clear. But I miss my loved ones. I want to see them now. Why did Jesus have to allow them to die now? I shared these texts last night. But for those who missed it, I want to give you hope for your loved ones. The Bible says in Psalms 116, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his wife. How can the death of his saints, his children, be precious? The Bible says in Proverbs 14:32, the wicked is driven away in his wickedness, but the righteous have hope in his death. Amen. What a promise, amen?
Amen.
God knows better. God knows the reason why our loved ones had to go through, why they're dead, why they're not with us. But he says in Isaiah 57, the righteous perish, and no man layeth to heart, and merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. Friends, all I know is Jesus has the keys of hell and death. Jesus knows why my loved one is dead at this moment. And I know that Jesus knows what's best, and he loves me more than I can ever dream of. And that loved one that I love with all my heart, he loves even more. So I can rest in the assurance that Jesus knows why. Amen. We can have peace in knowing that by God's grace, I will see my loved ones again.
Amen.
And this time, there will be no separation. We'll be able to spend all eternity with my loved one, but most importantly, with Jesus, the love of my life.
Amen.
My friends, I know this message may have been new to many of us, but I want to give you this peace and assurance that Jesus knows what's best. And although we may not know the reason why our loved ones had to die now, why they had to suffer so much, Jesus does. And I can rest assured that by God's grace, I will see them again. I can rest assured, at least at this moment, they are resting. They're not going through any more pain or suffering. How many of you tonight want to say with me, that God, I don't know why my loved one had to go so quickly, but you know why. You know what's best. And by God's grace, I will see them again. How many of you want to rest and be assured that Jesus has the keys of hell and death, and my loved ones will hear the most sweetest alarm clock they've ever heard, and I'll be able to spend all eternity with them? How many of you tonight want to accept the Bible doctrine that when you are dead, you are asleep? But just like the alarm clocks today wake us up, this alarm clock, by God's grace, will wake up our loved ones in Christ who will live forever. Amen.
Amen.
I am glad and thankful that we serve a living God that has and knows the reasons why things have to happen. But I know, by God's grace, we will all be caught up together to meet him in the air and spend all eternity with him. Amen.
Amen.
If that is your desire, if it is your desire to tell God, I know you know what is best, and I will rest just as my loved ones are resting now who are dead, I will rest and be assured that by your grace, I will see them again. Let me see your hands. Let's pray together. My Father which is in heaven, Lord, I know that we may have been taught differently, whether it be the headlines of the news, whether it be the latest books that are out. Father, whatever medium has told us, Father, that our loved ones are floating up in the sky, whether our loved ones are just in hell burning forever, Father, I'm thankful what the Bible says, that they are resting. They don't have to look down upon me and my family in this wicked world as we struggle and as we suffer. They don't have to be suffering in the flames of what people say is hell today. I'm thankful that you know what's best. That if I have lost a loved one, they are resting in the grave to hear the most sweetest alarm clock they have ever heard. Father, I pray that you may give us faith in your word. No matter how much we have been taught of something else, Father, help us accept the truth as it is in Jesus, and be comforted in knowing that you know what's best. Father, give us that assurance to live this life that we have in this moment, to glorify and honor you to the fullest, that by God's grace we may be caught up with you and our loved ones to live all eternity with each other again. Give us this courage and the zeal to live by every word that proceeds from your mouth. For I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. My dear friends, I'm thankful that you've been coming out. And I'm thankful that you're going to continue to come out. Amen? Amen. Friday, you're not going to want to miss this one, okay? This is like the question most of the majority of the world asks. If we do serve a God of love, why is there so much pain, suffering, sickness? If there is a God of love, why do so many good people have to suffer? This question, by God's grace, will be answered this Friday at what time? 7 o'clock. And you will be there, right? Amen? Amen. Bring your loved ones and family. The battle between good and evil. That's what we're going to find out Friday night. And Saturday night, we're going to learn eternal bliss or eternal woe. We're going to talk about something very powerful and beautiful. Come out, my brothers and sisters, and enjoy what the Word of God has to say. God bless you and enrich you. I'll see you later.
Be blessed by the message tonight. Thank you for coming tonight, and we want to remind you that tomorrow night, there's no meeting, but Friday night, we'll be back at 7 o'clock, and remember what I said, if you bring a guest, we'll have something special for you on Friday night, so bring a friend, someone that hasn't come before, you can bring them, and we'll have a special gift for you on Friday night. I want to tell you, just before you leave, that we have a team, and I am so encouraged, because we have a team that is praying every single night. During the message, they're praying for you. They're praying for these blue cards that you guys turned in the past few nights. They're praying for each person by name. If you have a special prayer request, you can fill that out in the card, and our team, our prayer team, will be praying for you. So I want to encourage you to fill one out and leave it as you leave tonight. And if you have a special burden you want to bring before the Lord, our prayer team is going to be right down front, and they will pray for you tonight before you leave. Don't forget also to pick up your study guide on tonight's topic as you leave from the registration desk. And we've got refreshments outside. We'll see you on Friday at 7. Bring a friend, and remember, God loves you. Good night.